Okay, thank you very much, everybody, for joining tonight. I appreciate the fact that everybody's here to participate. We've got three different events running at the same time tonight here in SG Innovate. So this is what I think is going to be the very cool part of the evening, our future of precision medicine. We have a talent networking event upstairs where we're trying to bring exciting men and women into contact with high potential startups. And then we've got a blockchain event that's being led by one of the co-founders of the Ethereum platform a couple of floors up. So a lot going on. This, I think, is going to be a great evening. We have three people with deep domain expertise, a passion for the topic, and some perspectives and points of view. And I'm encouraging you, please, don't leave it where you miss a chance to ask a question, because you won't find people that know more about these topics than the three gentlemen that will be speaking. The goal of tonight is simple. We're trying to raise the debate, raise the interest, raise the curiosity, raise the awareness for what I think is going to be so important for all of us, not just in Singapore, but around the world. And that is, how do we continue to think about the evolving future of medicine and this big word called personalized medicine, precision medicine? And so we've pulled together three amazing individuals that could be speaking anywhere around the world tonight, but they've chosen to spend the night here with you. So please make good use of their time. I won't do the injustice of introducing them, because then I would miss something that may be terribly important in their profile. So I'll ask them to self-introduce. We're going to go for about 10, 12 minutes per speaker. I'm going to go straight to you as the audience after that and say, what's on your mind based on what you've just heard? So with that in mind, let me please welcome to the stage Professor Sir David Lane. Sir David.
Well, thanks very much, Steve, and it's very nice to see so many people here. We're going through a kind of revolution in biology at the moment, and I think that's what this evening is about, and it creates many opportunities, many challenges. My own background is a PhD in immunology, and then I started to move into tumor biology, and I've really been working on the biology of cancer ever since. And my particular claim to fame is I was involved in the discovery of a very important tumor suppressor gene called P53, which is mutated in about half of all human cancers. So that finding has really driven my whole career to try and understand what that gene does and why it's mutated so often in human cancer. And I have been basically an academic, but I've also strayed into other areas. So in 1996, I started a biotechnology company in Dundee. That was quite difficult. Everybody said you can't have a biotechnology company in Dundee. It has to be in Slough. Slough was very popular for some reason at that time. Anyway, so I managed to do that, and you know, it's probably the least successful biotechnology company still on NASDAQ. But it was certainly a learning experience, and I learned a lot. So I kind of feel I have a little bit of a perspective from both sides. So I'm going to start, and we have two other fantastic speakers. So I'm going to slightly introduce things into this very interesting topic of personalized medicine. I'm going to take it from a cancer point of view, because most progress has been made actually in the field of cancer in this kind of work. But we, most of us in the field, believe this is going to be a paradigm for the future of all medicine. It's really understanding much more how medicine works at the individual level, how individual people differ, and how they might benefit better from medicine. So if we think about cancer, currently the way we treat cancer is principally with surgery, which is highly successful and is constantly improving, and there's all sorts of developments there, particularly in enhanced imaging. We used ionizing radiation, again, huge developments. The proton beam therapy, for example, is coming through. Many other developments are driven by physics. And conventional chemotherapy, and these are drugs like doxorubicin, camptothecin, platinum drugs, Taxol. They're drugs that are highly, highly effective. In some tumors, they're completely curative. For example, in testicular cancer in men, 97% cure rate of disseminated disease with one of these drugs. They have a bad rap because they have bad side effects, and they are rather nonspecific. And so the hope of cancer therapy is improved personalized treatment, where the drug is, or treatment is less toxic and it's more effective. Now, I think what we should emphasize, and Ravi will talk about it, the best way to cure a disease is not to get it in the first place. And one of the things I won't talk about very much today, though you'll reflect on it as I discuss the issue, is the question of early detection and prevention of disease is absolutely vital. And some of these processes of personalized medicine will lead us down that pathway of early detection and prevention. So this is the kind of paradigm that we realistically face. So for most drugs given to most people, a large number of people get no benefit. This is really an extraordinary fact, but it's very well documented, actually particularly for psychiatric treatment. Mostly it's placebo effect, as the current research shows. In the case of cancer, though, you see some patients respond extremely well to the drug and others don't. And the key question is, can you determine in advance who will respond and who won't respond? Can you pick out the right patient for the right drug? And so the idea is that if you understood the cancer better, and cancer is a particularly good disease for this because cancer contains a lot of genetic alterations, a lot of changes in the DNA. The cancer cells are very abnormal and they differ from one individual to another. Can you find out from analysis which patient's going to respond best to which drug? So you want what we call prognostic markers, markers that will give us an idea of what's going to happen in this person's cancer, and then markers of drug sensitivity and resistance, and markers predictive of adverse effects. And that's very important. All of those things are important. You don't want to treat a patient with a drug that's going to give a very bad side effect. So we see the growth, really, in cancer at the moment, and most of you will have seen stories in the newspapers about these types of new treatment. So one is immune therapy, where we're actually harnessing the body's own immune system to treat cancer. This is an extraordinary and explosive field. A disease like metastatic melanoma was pretty universally lethal 5 or 10 years ago, and now we're seeing people treated with 4 injections only of an antibody to their T cells, not even directed against their tumor, and they're cured 10 years later, no disease. So an incredible change in the field. It's not working for every patient, so the key area here is to understand why some patients respond better than others and how we can use these current drugs and many more that are coming more effectively. In the case of the small molecule drugs and antibodies, these are directed against specific genetic changes in the tumor, and here, again, we're trying to understand how to match these drugs to the tumor. So the problem with these molecules, and we'll probably discuss this as we go into a more general discussion, is they're very expensive. And the current course of immunotherapy might cost 100 to 300,000 euros per year. And there's very few biomarkers. So we don't know which patients are really going to get the benefit, which means the cost to the community, the cost to society of these drugs is even higher. And the same to some extent with the targeted therapy with designer drugs. So some of these are still very expensive. The few early ones are just beginning to come off patent, so their costs will drop. And again, we need to have appropriate biomarkers, ways of determining which patients should get this drug. In some cases, it's simple, because in a particular type of cancer, chronic myeloid leukemia, nearly everybody has the same genetic change. And so in that disease, we know what drug to give. But in many other cancers, like ovarian cancer or lung cancer, there are different forms of the disease, and we don't know which drug to give until we subdivide the patients on the basis of their genetic alterations. So the very high cost of these personalized treatments makes the companion diagnostic essential. And these kinds of molecules are talked about, all these processes, as theradiagnostics. Their diagnostics are going to be used associated with a particular therapy. So this is an area of immense interest in the field, the understanding of how to match the drug to the patient to ensure a good response, and how to do that cost-effectively and efficiently. So this is an example of a clinical decision that has to be made. If you're a patient with colorectal cancer, and you're potentially going to be treated by this antibody drug, cetuximab. Cetuximab is a drug that inhibits the signaling through the EGFR receptor. This molecule is often overexpressed or altered in colorectal cancer, and some patients get a terrific response if they're given this antibody. Some patients don't respond at all. And it turns out that the difference that took some time to determine is whether downstream of the EGFR is a gene called RAS. Now, if the RAS gene is mutated, it's signaling all the time. So blocking the upstream signal doesn't do any good. If the RAS gene is wild type, blocking this signal does a lot of good. So you see a very strong anti-cancer effect here. You see nothing here. So there's no point in giving this very expensive drug to patients who have a RAS mutation. So what the FDA has said is you must determine whether this patient has a RAS mutation in order to decide whether to give this very expensive drug, because it does have side effects. So for example, this particular drug causes quite a nasty skin reaction. You don't want to give it to people who don't need it. You're actually harming them rather than helping them. So the issue then becomes how to do this test, on what sample and when. And the old way that we used to look at cancer was to take a little piece of the cancer itself and analyze it, both histology and at the molecular level. And Huck will talk later about some of the tremendous tools we have for molecular analysis that allow us to sequence tumors very quickly and efficiently. So that was the way we used to do it. What we're beginning to realize now is a fantastic opportunity to be able to do this on a simple blood sample. So this is really the new end, I think, of cancer diagnostics, is the ability to work with samples not taken from the tumor, but taken from the circulation. So what we have discovered, and the we is very much the royal me, because I've had absolutely nothing to do with these discoveries myself, is that tumors actually pump out a lot of material into the bloodstream. They plump out DNA from the tumor. And the tumor DNA contains mutations, because it's not the same as the normal DNA in normal cells, because the tumor actually has selected for certain mutations, a good growth advantage, and also the DNA is chemically modified, for example, by methylation. So all of these things allow us to distinguish tumor DNA from normal DNA. So we actually can measure, if you like, the presence of a tumor by its product that appears in the bloodstream. And so this allows us to look at all these different processes. Why does this happen? Why do you see these products from the tumor in the bloodstream? And it's because tumor cells are dying. So we think about tumors growing very fast, and they do, but they're also dying very fast. So they actually grow relatively slowly compared with the rate of cell division. And many of the cells are dying through these different processes, particularly this process called apoptosis. And this death of the tumor cells is what releases material into the bloodstream, which can then be measured very accurately. So this process of being able to find DNA in the blood from tumors first started actually from the discovery that you could detect DNA from the fetus in the tumor. And this has led to an enormous industry now, worth billions of dollars, which allows us, for example, to determine if a baby has Down syndrome simply by taking a sample of the mother's blood. You don't have to do an invasive amniocentesis. You don't essentially need a biopsy. So the same kind of technology, and we learned a lot from this, from the fetal work. In fact, the half-life of DNA in the blood is quite short. That means this is actually a dynamic marker. The tumor cell has to keep making the molecule in order for it to be detected. So we find that as soon as a mother's given birth, the fetal DNA disappears from their bloodstream quite quickly. So this allows us then to extend this technique. And it was first discovered in the 1970s, in the 80s, further work was done. But really, it's with the new technologies that Huck will describe, a very intense sequencing that have allowed this method to really take off. And now, essentially, for every patient with cancer, we can have a marker of their cancer in the blood. This allows us to monitor the growth of that tumor, whether it's responded to therapy, and potentially in the future might allow very advanced diagnosis. So we can really begin to profile the tumor. You don't need to take a biopsy. You don't have to fix the material. And you can begin to look at all the different types of cancer and get a much better evaluation of the reaction to therapy and the development of resistance. So in a very specific example, Bert Vogelstein and his colleagues have shown that if after surgery for colorectal cancer, no circulating DNA is found in the blood, the person doesn't need follow-on chemotherapy, which is a great problem for people. And if they don't need it and get no benefit from it, they shouldn't have it. On the other hand, if you find tumor DNA in the blood a few weeks after the surgery, they clearly haven't completely successfully removed the tumor and they need follow-on chemotherapy. So that's just one example of how this kind of approach can be used. And one of the benefits, in a way, of this is the problem of tumor heterogeneity. So what we find in human tumors is there are different regions and subregions of the tumor. So when we take a little sample of the tumor, we sometimes only find one mutation, say the EGFR mutation, but we don't find the KRAS mutation. So the biopsy doesn't give us a complete picture of the tumor, and we might then treat inefficiently because we wouldn't use the appropriate drugs for each type of alteration that's occurred in that tumor. With a liquid biopsy, potentially, we have the potential to see all the alterations in the tumor and give appropriate treatment. So this has led to a huge outgrowth of technology and companies, and there's enormous opportunity here. We need much better technology. We need new ways of doing these tests, and they require technological innovation because the amount of DNA in the blood is small. The amount of normal DNA in the blood, relatively speaking, is high, and the ability to make the distinction is critical. So it's a huge potential market, and you can see the number of companies here that are involved. This is an example of a company in Belgium, and this is the kit that they're offering, essentially. They'll take a blood sample, and they'll determine 90 mutations in 9 cancer genes in 3 weeks for 650 euro. And so that's a challenge. Obviously, one of you out here will develop the way to do that in 2 days for 5 euro, or 1 hour for 1 euro. And that will be a brilliant business. And you know, working out how to do that's what's going to change how these things work. So the challenges are actually beginning to become quite clear. One of the most successful companies, a foundation in the United States, it was started off by Third Rock and Alexei Borisy and others, and it's gone from, you know, a tiny little company to something that Roche bought, I think, 54% of for over $1 billion. So this gives you an idea of the demand and potential in this, because if you get this right, then as a pharmaceutical company, your drug works most of the time, and that's hugely important for getting approval for that molecule and getting it to sell at the price you wanted to sell. So what's the future here? I'll finish by saying it's the usual things. You know, how do you make it faster? How do you give it more range? How do you make it cheaper? And how do you automate it? Thank you.
Right, I want to start by thanking Steve for the opportunity over here. David talked a lot about one of the fastest moving areas in cancer, immunotherapy and liquid biopsy. So for me, I'm going to talk about technology. And there's no better time to become a researcher to drive innovation compared to right now. And I'm going to talk about how technology will change medicine, and medicine is all about humans. How do we treat diseases? How do we prevent diseases? So this is all about medicine, it's all about humans. And one of the disruptive technology is shown over here. Many, many years ago, some of the clinicians in the room will recognize this particular very high-tech instrument many, many years ago, right? If you look back, this almost feel like this. Different people with different senses trying to understand what exactly is the elephant in the room, right? So this was before, and over the years, tremendous achievement has been done, particularly in the electronics sector. I still can remember in the year around 2000, I used to type my thesis using this particular computer called the iMac. You just have to look at the stats of the iMac over here and compare that with what you have in your pocket, which is this. They are almost identical. If not, the iPhone has exceeded the spec that one can put into a laptop computers in the year 2000. So, and this is primarily driven by the phenomenon called the Moore's Law, which describes the event that happened to be able to squeeze more and more transistor into a smaller space very fast within a very short time. And what about in the biomedical area? We are experiencing a very similar phenomenon. And I just want to highlight this particular moonshot project. Right, this moonshot in the biomedical area is to sequence our own genomes, the genome of human beings. And the project, the first project took more than 13 years. You just cannot imagine the price tag. It costs more than $100 million to sequence the first human genome. Right, it was done. There was a big celebration in the year 2000 and 2003. And 2000 and 2003 is not far away from now. In fact, 2000 was the time that I was trying to graduate. I graduated from PhD. So this is a chart. Some of my colleagues from Illumina in the room would be very familiar. This is the cost of sequencing one human genome, right? As I mentioned, it used to be more than $100 million a genome. And you can see right now, in fact, this is an outdated slide. The problem is that if you are in the sequencing arena, you have to update your stats very fast. In the year 2014, the cost of one genome is about $1,000. And with all this technological advancement, you can almost reconstruct the fine detail of the elephant, right? To talk to you about the technology, I'm going to briefly mention three different areas that we are seeing the fastest advancement in technology. Firstly, our ability to read the human genome. Secondly, our ability to reprogram the human genomes. And finally, to push it a bit further, our ability to edit the human genomes, right? So this is where our institute spent a lot of time, day and night, trying to do research along these three areas. I'm just going to give you a sense of how things are moving, right? So this is one of the state-of-the-art thumb drive sequencer, which I will mention at the end of my talk. To give you a sense of how things move, maybe let me ask you a question. Using this particular machine from Illumina, how many genomes can be sequenced in a week? Any taker? How many genomes? It can be 100, it can be 10, it can be 1. Just a rough guess. How many takers? By the way, those individuals from the Genome Institute of Singapore are barred from this particular contest. Anyone? 100? You are ahead of your time. So, if you ask the question in the year 2021, the answer is 2 human genomes. If you ask the question in the year 2013, using an upgraded version of the machines, is 3 genomes, right? So the answer depends on when you ask the question. If you ask the question in the year January 2014, the answer is 32 genomes, right? So this, I hope, illustrate to you how fast the technology is moving right now. And it's just amazing that all these things are happening while we are discussing over here. And I want to pose you another question. Using the latest release of the Illumina machines, what is the cost of a genome in a few years' time? And, well, by the way, you're absolutely right. How do you know? So not only the throughput are increasing, the cost is also dropping at a rate which is unparalleled in the entire history of biomedical science. So, and this opened up a lot of opportunities. David talked about liquid biopsy and raised, what is possible right now is to be able to sequence the blood of the mother in order to figure out the health status of the fetus. And obviously, this opened up tremendous opportunity, both in terms of research as well as innovations, right? I'm going to move into another area, which is reprogramming the human genomes, right? Medicine is about human beings. It's about whether or not we have access to human materials to work on, right? So this was a landmark discovery by this gentleman called Professor Shinya Yamanaka. And in the year 2006, he published a paper that shocked the whole world. What was this paper about? He took a mouse skin cells and introduced 4 different molecules. And from this mouse skin cells, he can convert the skin cells into what is called a pluripotent stem cells, right? And what is what is the meaning of pluripotency? Pluripotency means that the cell can differentiate into all cell types in our body. So it was a breakthrough simply because for the very first time in the history of mankind, we can take anyone in this room and create stem cells out of you. Pluripotent stem cells for everyone in this room. The next year, many other laboratories shows that it is possible to take human skin cells and reprogram them into human pluripotent stem cells. So, and what is this opening up? It's opening up an entire field of creating stem cells and making in vitro artificial organs out of these stem cells. So it is possible in the year 2017, right? And the last technology I'm going to cover is the ability to engineer the human genomes, right? And where did it start? It started with this molecule called the zinc finger nuclease. The zinc finger nuclease was very expensive, right? And the advancement in this technology is the development and the advancement of the CRISPR technology, which allow us to edit our human genome with very high precision. If you want to learn more, one of the experts for zinc for CRISPR technology is actually in this room. So if you want to talk more about that, I can introduce you to that gentleman sitting right in this line. So some of the application is shown in this particular slide. We can think about gene correction. And this is one of the paper that shows it is possible to correct a mouse model of hemophilia B in vivo. And this is a second example which shows that it is possible to mutate the CCR5 gene, which is a co-receptor for HIV. So you can just imagine, we can now think of all sort of different type of gene editing experiment in the cell. So today, these are the three technology that is available for research to sequence our genomes. We can sequence everybody in this room. We can create iPS cells, everybody in this room. We can even think about correcting the genomes of your iPS cells. And where are we heading? I just want to give you a bit of forecast about where the technology is moving. So this is a machine that performs single molecule real-time sequencing. And this is another device, which is this big, that performs real-time sequencing. So I believe that, you know, in the next few years, we are going to see a lot of this technology coming on board. And where are we in terms of making synthetic human organs? This is what we need, but it's not possible unless you can convince anyone in the right mind. But now we have the technology to even create in vitro artificial brain organs in the laboratory. So with that, I'll thank you very much for your attention. I will be very happy to discuss more during the discussion.
Well, first of all, Steve, thanks for setting this up, and thank you all for actually coming in. I could have been many places, but I think this is more exciting, so I'll be here. And at least you'll see me for at least 10, 15 minutes here. Can everyone hear me okay? Thank you. So what I'm going to focus on is I came to Singapore around 4 years ago. I've been coming back and forth, but I came 4 years ago to actually set up a company here. And I wanted to be in medical, although I can't spell the word medical. I have a technical background. I've done a lot of things in technology, but nothing in medical whatsoever. The first person I met when I came here was David Lane, actually. So at that time, I decided my passion became determination to be in medicine. So what I was trying to solve was first understanding what healthcare is all about. How do you define healthcare as a word, and what does it mean to people? The second thing was, how do I get meetings with famous doctors so I could actually understand? And obviously, without a medical background, you can't approach these people. So I had to invent a couple of funny words so I could get meetings with a lot of folks. So the word called little data was a tagline because everyone talks about big data. So I said, well, I'm the little data company. And the question was, what the hell does that mean? Come and see me. So that's how I got some meetings, actually. But jokes aside, everyone in this room has their own data. Big data will mask individual data. So you'll get a statistic, but you won't get a specific solution to it. So our goal as a company based in Singapore is to buy, invest, build technologies which actually solve that problem. So let's start with, we are here based in Singapore. That's my email address, feel free to reach out. But what we are is the little data company. And I'll define in a few words as we go forward what that means and how we are actually approaching and solving the problem. For me, healthcare is two things. You delay the onset of a chronic ailment. That delays a lot of expenses related to healthcare, so that's important. And if you do get a chronic ailment, then you need to be able to manage it well. So if you could do those two things, you can actually save tremendous amount of money in healthcare. And the numbers are pretty dramatic, and I'll show you some numbers as we go forward. So I have a lot of friends who work at IBM and different companies and Illumina, and then they all focus on big data. I have no capacity to compete with them, at least on a knowledge basis. But my simple words to them are, all big data is institution specific. So you can find out how many people in my zip code, what percentage will die of cancer, but they can't tell me whether I'll die of cancer. It's as simple as that, right? So I'm a statistic as far as they're concerned. It's going from specific to a statistic. So little data is specific to you, me, or someone in this room. I don't want to be a statistic, I want to be specific. And what that allows you to do is, if you could focus on little data, then you are precise versus being general. So between those three things, you can actually define really clear pathways on what data you need to collect for specific markers in the human body. To me, my definition of precision, I'm a technology background guy. It has to be event-based. Some event needs to happen, you need to capture it. It needs to be real-time or near real-time, because anything which is delayed is actually meaningless in terms of what it means to a disease or a cure. It has to be clinically accurate. Fitbits are great for you to take a long walk, but it's not good enough to tell you whether you are going to fail or your heart will have a problem. And needs to be actionable. So once you're clinically accurate, the healthcare professional can actually tell you what action to take. Right? So I always bring this slide up because not because I understand it, it's because I kind of connect the dots between a patient and a payer. In all parts of the world, you always have a patient, you always have something in the middle which is a lot of stuff, and then there's a payer who's gonna try to pay all this stuff, right? In some parts of the world, the payer and the patient are the same person, which is, you know, me paying for my stuff. And this, for me, captures it all. Inaccurate, slow, and insufficient data is the leading data leading to poor and late diagnosis is the largest cost in healthcare. And I'll give you the numbers, they're dramatic. If you were to go to the US, $2 trillion was spent last year in healthcare. 30% of that is related to cardiac, so about $675 billion. Of that, 30%, which is close to $200 billion, is lost in the shuffle in the middle, actually. Because you're repeating tests, you're delaying data, you take bad tests, everyone, all the practitioners go back. You go to a doctor, he wants to take your test again because he doesn't believe the previous test or data got lost. The reason I got into this, my mom came from India to US to visit me. It took me $800, 3 weeks to get an X-ray from India over to US, right? So the fundamental issue is I can't fix the outcome. I'm not a doctor. David is and Professor Hawk is. I can't lower the cost for a payer because there's a set standard on how they pay. What I can fix is what happens in the middle. So our focus as a company has been, how do you go to the middle, which is diagnostics, hospitals, all these facilities which exist for healthcare, and you optimize it. Optimizing a specific item in healthcare doesn't work because that's a niche solution for a few people. But you actually have to optimize the system. So even though they call it the healthcare continuum, I actually have slides which say the healthcare continuum because it is real hell once you get into that system and coming out of it, right? I don't use the word here because I've been told not to use it anymore. So of all the things I talked about, for me, the missing links are very simple. Anything you do in healthcare is, everybody thinks a minimum procedure cost is $500. I don't care what you do, it's 500 bucks because some healthcare person is involved, doctor is involved, you have to go someplace, all kinds of stuff happen. So the missing links are, anything you do has to be inexpensive, it has to be disposable so you're not tied to a bunch of wires on your body or any of those things. And then it has to be agnostic. So if I can do a lot of things in software, I can buy very low cost hardware. Just like your PC and just like you said, the Mac became cheaper, the iPhone became cheaper, because economies of scale works in every field. In healthcare, they haven't applied it properly. So that was our goal, start with that. It has to be real time. If you don't give real time data, you have a fundamental problem in healthcare because you are now making decisions based on inaccurate information. Simple example, I can go to a doctor today, show them my heart rate, and they'll say, well, you're 54. I go tomorrow, it's 96, they'll put me on a pill. Well, yesterday was 54, today is 96, how'd you make that decision? You have no baseline. If the baseline doesn't exist, all decisions are tactical. Tactical decisions, in my mind, are one of the largest costs in healthcare. And then, so when you create the little data for each individual, you're creating a baseline, and this baseline allows you to now track this patient if required. The other thing which fascinating to me is we took 1,000 ECGs, and I'll show you an example. We gave it to cardiologists in US. 47% of ECGs read after 5 p.m. were incorrect. So you were flipping a coin when you went to a cardiologist. We take the same data, put it in through our algorithm, were 99.2% accurate. In fact, we got a patent on this. Very simple. Human beings, when they're tired, deluge of data doesn't work. Because you can only see so many things. I mean, on a clear night, you see 1,000 stars. There are billions, but you only see those. It's the same thing in data. You show someone an ECG, look at a bunch of numbers, say, it looks normal. But they don't know when it was taken, why it was taken, and what was the baseline around it. And the last piece of the puzzle, which I think is one of the worst one, is how do you eliminate redundant processes? And it is mind-boggling how many redundant processes happen. And we have numbers, statistics to show that. So I talked about cardiac because it was the largest healthcare cost, but it blends very well with cancer. People who have cancer and they're going through chemotherapy, they actually get tremendous amount of cardiotoxicity. And there's no real way to measure it until you monitor a patient consistently. So what we did was, this picture, I started working on this 4 years ago. Said no longer a picture, we actually have real products. And these products sell in the market. So how do you start the process? As a cardiac, I need three things. I need your electrical signals, which is what we call the ECG. I need your visual signals, that's the ultrasound. Then I need some sensors to do clinical pathology like blood tests, saliva tests, urine tests, that's the biosensors. All that data needs to be analyzed and goes to some storage mechanism. From there, it can be thrown into data analytics, to healthcare providers. But if you notice this picture, every individual who's here has a folder in there. So this is no longer big data. It's aggregation of a lot of little data to make big data. But each folder is specific to you. There's nobody else involved in that process. What this allows you to do, and here are the numbers for people who want to calculate. If you were to do these three things, for a cardiac patient today in the United States, it takes 2 weeks, close to $8,000, and you go and see about 5 doctors. With our technology today, and this is all working, by the way, we have people are actually using it, the total time is 17 minutes. You can do it in your office or house, really doesn't matter, and you get the data back in 1 hour total. So you took an $8,000 cost and brought it down in time to basically half an hour. That was the first part. So that's a time savings, that's productivity and all that stuff. The second part was, what is the cost? this patch, which is our ECG patch, and I have an example if someone wants to take a look at it, it's right here. This is actually a disposable, world's first wireless disposable ECG patch. It actually costs us $2 to manufacture. The wires you buy for an ECG monitor in the hospital cost $15. Right? So what we are doing is we are focusing on how do you take the cost of these expensive equipment and take it out of the picture. So I was in a hospital here last week, and they asked me what is the cost of our service. I said, it's free unless you use it. So you don't buy anything from me. I just give you a patch. When you attach it, your data goes to the cloud. We analyze it. We give you real-time data or good data. You pay. If not, you don't have to do anything. You throw it away. There's a lot of technology in there, obviously, but all done using chips. So to your point, we went from iMac to iPhone. We went from a Holter monitor with 14 electrodes and a big patch here, which does four readings, to this device for $2 and actually supports features like microphone, speaker, so your cardiologist can actually talk back with you. Right? Now, you can't do it in US yet, but they can tell you that you're smoking and stop, right? Okay. So all this stuff is not something I understand in terms of how to do it, but to build it properly, we had to create public-private partnerships. So some of it I actually licensed from Mayo, some of it I bought companies. So over the last 4 years, we've put this framework together. It's fully functional, and it's been used in a lot of places right now. And before I forget, so once you have all this information, what does that allow you to do? That simplifies and changes a clinical workflow for a hospital. Now, why is this picture important, right? So I don't know how many people know about this disease called sepsis. So sepsis is actually a man-made disease. You go to a hospital, you go and have a minor cut, the guy gives you medication, you come out, you've acquired a virus or a bacteria, you come home, your body is on fire, and your body parts are failing. Every hour you delay sepsis detection actually will increase your chances of dying by 8%. So after 5 hours, you will actually be worked on by about 20 doctors at a time, right? So with all the stuff we did here, I send a patient home, and I can monitor them wirelessly. So essentially what I can do is, if you look at the number where it says medium high on top, that's your sepsis score. So I can send the patient home. As their statistics are changing, I can track it and actually tell you whether this patient will get sepsis 26 hours in advance. That in itself is equivalent to $35 billion in direct savings in the United States today. 250,000 people will die this year from sepsis in the United States because they could not get the detection done. So the key here is that the cost to get the data has to be very low. It has to actually work in such a way that you provide the right data sets. So when the doctors or the healthcare professionals look at it, they can easily make diagnoses and decisions which create tremendous amount of value, not just from a standpoint of money savings, but the outcome. Because this is a real case. Cardiotoxicity is a serious issue, right? People will go for chemotherapy, they don't die of cancer, they actually end up dying of cardiac issues because the cardiac system fails. So our key from a Renew standpoint, from a company standpoint, is commercializing very, very low cost ways of getting into the market. So you are reducing the cost of hardware equipment. And the best example I can give you, I was in a hospital in Ireland, and we actually looked at a bed. So typical, when you go to a hospital bed in ICU, the space it takes is 8 feet by 4 feet. That's 32 square feet, and there's 64 square feet of equipment around it. And that's how they model it. So in one room, you have one patient. So we have a virtual model which shows you actually one bed, same thing in half the space. So the same room can actually now have two patients. So from a hospital standpoint, it's a real estate problem they're solving. From a patient standpoint, you're getting better outcomes, and you're not tethered to anything. So key here is untether the patient from the diagnosis by reducing the wires, basically. Make it clutter-free. So where are we in this process? To create global impact, you have to be unique. You have to be disruptive. And disruption doesn't come from passion, it comes from determination. I mean, I can be passionate about something, someone will slap me and I'll go do something else. But you have to be really determined, right? So key is disruptive economics. Unless you do that, it doesn't change anything. So when I go and present this solution to people, cardiologists tell me, why should I talk to you? I said, this one. And they, what is this? It's a $1,000 Holter monitor, which is for free. Then they listen. Now the service behind it is still $50, $100, doesn't matter. But this is disposable. I can throw it away and I'm done. So the key is to make it disposable. It has to be hardware agnostic. As we go forward, hardware is only going to get cheaper and cheaper and cheaper and better. If you are hardware agnostic, you can actually add new elements, new sensors much quicker than actually saying I'm in the hardware business. Right? It has to be, so we call it the PDAS, which is Precise Diagnostics as a Service. So once I put the patch on, I can remotely detect if there's any problem with the data you're collecting, actually. And I can send a signal via email, via SMS, through the microphone to say, move the patch. And that actually people can fix. So we have a lot of things we have done to augment the lack of knowledge people have when they're trying to do these things. It has to be clinically actionable. It's very critical, because without that, no doctor will talk to you. So we call this point of care, little data. And what that means to me is it's precise, it's accurate, but it's yours, meaning it applies to you. It's not a part of a large statistic someplace. I think someone asked me this question about, you know, how do we create these partnerships? So one of them, which I'm working on right now as you speak, we are the company here. I put a question mark because someone told me don't put the letter there, but I'm sure you can guess. In the middle is, what we do is we will actually invest. I'll first go talk to them and say, show me what you have. Then I'll tell them what my application is. I will hire the researcher, provide the funding, provide all the equipment, whatever is required. Then we build it, and you can see the fruit of this. Typically, this process would take about 5-6 years. We actually got a commercially viable graphene membrane for water filtration from Singapore in actually 11 months, right? And it works. So all this stuff was done, and I use the word, I just give you an example, we have other projects like this, but the key here is that you can work with facilities and research people. It's very complicated. I mean, you gotta simplify the process. So it took me a while to actually straighten the stuff out, but my angle on everything is, if I'm not making money, then I'm a charity. If I'm a charity, I can only volunteer, I can't give you anything. So this is more about business philanthropy. How do you solve the big picture? So I can solve the problem for a lowest common denominator. My patch in India will cost you $2, so everyone can use it. In US, it'll cost you $1,000 because they can afford it. So it depends on where you are, and that solves the problem. So in closing, you know, I have this very simple line. If the diagnosis is delayed or wrong, the cure is irrelevant. So precise diagnostics is important. It has to be applicable to you, and you can't be a part of a statistic. That doesn't help anybody. That's me, and thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Ravi, and thank you, Huck, and thank you, David. So what we're gonna do now, if I can just ask you three gentlemen to please take a seat, wherever you like. I'm going to sit on the end. Okay, so as promised, we've tried to bring interesting topics for the purpose of discussing and thinking out loud about what does this mean to Singapore, but importantly, what does it mean for everybody around the world. I don't really want to be the one to ask questions. I have a few in the pocket. I'd rather go straight to you and see if we can get that started. So what I'm going to do is just ask, is there somebody in the audience that would like to kick off the questions, and we'll figure it out? Yes, sir.
So my question is for Ravi. So what is the error rate of your system compared to conventional system which people were using? So error rate of like detecting it right or wrong, ECG, let's say, compared to the conventional system. And who owns the data, like patient or you?
So it depends on what country you're in. If in Singapore, typically it's the hospital which owns the data and they can decide how to disseminate it. Accuracy, we are FDA approved everywhere. So that's not an issue. We have CE marks and all that stuff. So all the devices we talk about, they're all approved by regulatory bodies everywhere. So we have HSA, CE, and all that stuff. So from a data perspective, we find two things. If you're in US, it's anonymized, and the data resides actually in this cloud. What we do is we create the model in such a way you can do public private cloud. So if you're a hospital, you can own the data and anonymize it. So we can work on it outside, but it still belongs to you. In US, typically, they never release data to patients anyway. Whereas in Singapore, they want to release it to patients. So for us, we are agnostic. We don't care because it's fully anonymized. And we meet all the HIPAA guidelines. And we are actually certified by NHS in UK. And we have about close to 200,000 people are using our system globally, actually. Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Okay. What else? Okay, I'll fill in the gap while you're thinking. And that is, there's some people that think about precision medicine as a unit of one, that each of us knows whatever we need to know about ourselves. There's some people that think of stratification, and I just need to put people into relatively significant groups, whether it's 5 or 6 or 7. So is there a thought that in order for more people to be able to make use of all of the technology that the three of you have been discussing, do we think about each person having their genome sequenced, or do we think about something just being a stratification and I know enough to get some sort of help? How do we think of this in terms of real life use case?
Well, I'll have a go. I think in the long run, absolutely. Everybody will have their own genome sequenced and it will be individual. But there's clearly going to be, and there already is, an intermediate place where, for example, in cancer you can say, this person has this particular mutation, and that's a group stratification. It's very powerful. But I think what we're beginning to realize is the enormous effect of other genes, even on a particular gene, and the tissue-specific effects. So, BRAF mutation in melanoma, melanomas respond very well to a BRAF inhibitor. BRAF mutation in colorectal cancer, same mutation, they don't respond very well to the inhibitor. We don't know why. So I think the key is always going to be this deeper and deeper dive. And I think there's the sort of very good, David Wetherill did very good genetics a very long time ago on the hemoglobin deficiencies. And I remember still strikingly, he showed me two children. They both had the same exact point mutation. One child was pretty healthy and the other child was in a terrible state. And that's obviously to do with the background, the genetic background of those individuals. So I do think in the long run, the interpretation of the total genome is going to be very, very valuable. And as Huck said, the cost is dropping so low. So actually, the challenge is not going to be collecting the data. It's going to be clearly the analysis of the data.
The way I think about this is I always try to mirror what we experience in terms of technology in relation to the internet. We know about Internet of Things. We know what the internet has enabled. So the way I think about health and medicine is we need to think about internet of health and internet of life. It's not only about collecting genome sequence data. It's about how do you apply artificial intelligence to make sense out of the data, and we are only going to see more and more data. The reason for saying that passionately is because in our institute, we always have to worry about how are we going to finance our computer storage? So with denser and denser data, with lower, that problem is not helped by the dropping in sequencing costs. We're going to collect more data than we ever before. How do we make sense of that data and how do we learn from that data? I think that's going to be the key, and that's going to transform medicine.
So let me ask you a question, just as a quick one here. If we all had our genome sequence, and we all had a long list, if we take the sort of HLI approach and Craig Venter and the idea of the owner's manual for the human body, do we risk flooding the healthcare system with people that run in and say, I need this procedure and I'm worried about this? And is there a downside to knowing more as much as there's an upside to knowing more?
I think that horse has already galloped out of the stable. I mean, every doctor I meet says, every patient comes to me and they've looked up and they've got some obscure form of, you know, disease because they saw it on the internet. That's clearly a huge challenge. I guess most of us will spend the evening studying our genomes, and that will stop us wasting time watching television and things. But, it is a really enormously interesting issue as to how this data, will be handled. But this, in a strange way, you know, it's your identity, I think. I think there's something very deep here, actually, and I think it's really, really interesting. I think people will want to know, and they will perhaps take more care of themselves. And is it so wrong that we diagnose ourselves? I mean, you know, I'm not so clear in my mind. I think we're going to go to a very different world, actually. And a lot of these things are actionable, and they are surprising. So one of the things we're learning, and Huck will tell you more about it, is that a surprising number of human diseases are caused by germline defects, much more than we realized as we sequence. And some of these are new mutations. So 1 in 10 children who have cancer have a germline mutation in P53, 1 in 10. We had no idea of that. We had a rare genetic disease that we call Li-Fraumeni syndrome. It's where we could trace the gene from the parent to the child, and these would be cancer families. But now we just look at the somatic mutation that's happening during the development of the child, right at the start of the development of the embryo, and the mutation's already there. So what we consider to be a genetic disease, because we could see inheritance from the parents, we now realize is a germline mutation in that individual, a new mutation. This is much more common than we thought. So this is really beginning to change how we think about things. We don't know enough about that yet, but it's a very surprising realization that's come out of the genome projects.
Well, the way I think about this is that getting human sequence will not be limiting. It's not the limiting factor in 5 years' time. Understanding disease is the limiting factor. You know, how do you correlate with different types of genetic changes to specific phenotype? That is going to be the biggest bottleneck in the entire history of biomedical science. And, you know, it's almost like now you have created the internet of DNA. How do you understand that? How do you collect additional data? How do you have validation? How do you make sure that the rules that we learned is valid? So that is going to be the biggest bottleneck that we'll face in the next 5 years.
So my question goes towards like more proteomics than genomics, because proteomics is basically dependent on the genes, how they express during a specific event. Can you actually use genomic data to predict the outcome of the proteins after? So can you actually use the same kind of techniques you are already applying for genomics, also to basically forecast what's going to happen, which event's going to influence specific groups of people to get a specific disease? Can you do that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really good question. We know there isn't a linear relationship between the gene and the level of the protein product, or indeed the function of that protein. But again, you know, there's this huge technology change, which is the developments in mass spectroscopy, and we're seeing again a similar level of revolution. So we're now able to analyze very accurately protein molecules and their relative amounts. And I think, again, we might see, you know, it's essentially what, in a way, Huck was talking about, that the genotype doesn't give you the phenotype. Understanding the proteins potentially gives you very important phenotypic information. So I think, again, we're just in the beginnings of another revolution, but it is a remarkable one. So every week, practically, the mass spec gets much better. I suppose one of the biggest changes, actually, is when I started in biology, it was infinite. I could go and discover a new gene. I did. I mean, most of my colleagues discovered new genes. You know, we isolated the yeast PCNA. Oh, good, that was Wednesday. What will we do tomorrow? You know, so now it's never going to do that. I mean, there's one or two new genes being discovered in Singapore, which is very exciting, but there aren't going to be many left. And it's the same with everything else. So suddenly, what was infinite, and I think our thinking was of it being infinite, is now actually limited and precise, and actually I think the way we do biology has to change. We have to be much more serious about it. Historically, I think we were kind of casual. You know, you push this, this happens, you push that, that happens. Actually, we can now do it to a much higher degree of accuracy, and I think that's what's coming with single cell work, with microfluidics, with RNA-seq, all these methods, that the rules of relationship between you know, genotype, phenotype, and how all these proteins function will be resolved. The current model for academic science is terrible for doing this. I mean, because everybody works on the same thing. You know, actually, we should all be working on different things. Everybody should have their own protein. You know, there aren't that many. I mean, so there's many, many, many more scientists working in biology than there are proteins. But some hundreds of thousands, you know, a lot of them aren't being studied at all, right? It's kind of crazy if you think about it. We just need a bit more organization. Anyway, but it's an interesting topic.
Well, as the head of a genome institute, you can almost imagine my answer is going to be heavily biased. So you know, you're absolutely right. We need to think about proteome, metabolome. You know, there's all sort of data that we can potentially collect. But by the end of the day, we're going to see an explosion of data, and it's the learning that is the critical. It's the most critical piece in this whole endeavors. The learning of the rules.
I have one more question based on genome sequencing. So we know most of disease happens in an organ and very few diseases are systematic. So what should we sequence? We should sequence blood or we should start sequencing each and every organ?
Well, actually, that's one of the few questions we can answer rather definitely. It's fine to sequence the blood. Basically, what's going on in our bodies, apart from in cancer and maybe a little bit in some other diseases, is that the way the genome is controlled is by different organs switching on and off different genes, and the control processes are beginning to be understood. So you don't need to sequence every organ. Sequencing the DNA in the blood is fine. For cancer, it's completely different because we see many, many mutations. And so that does sort of make things simpler. In other words, the DNA that's in your heart is the same sequence as that in your blood as in your eye. At least I believe so. Maybe Huck knows different. I'll ask him.
Well, we want to push it one step further. So we are starting a project which is called the Sequencing a Hospital Project, right? We are thinking of sequencing the patients. We are thinking of sequencing the environment. We are thinking of sequencing the ICU. So, you know, one can get all sort of information from DNA. The reason is because living things live behind DNA, and these are footprints that you can follow. So, you know, this is how we think about sequencing, but obviously, when you talk to people from the Genome Institute of Singapore, this is exactly how we think.
There was a question in the back, I think. Yeah. So, my question's, I would say, it's surrounding the dangers of AI in medicine. So the basis of medicine, the basis of science has been cause and effect. And when you look at AI, you're just looking at effect, and you're working backwards from there. And the loss of knowledge, actually, in medicine. So I work in projects in fetal and obstetrics, and I've seen the dangers of pattern recognition without understanding physiology. And it's something that was touched on by Ravi as well, identifying sepsis, but the doctors don't know the cause. And I've seen this a while, and I would just love to get your opinions on the topic, actually. Has AI accelerated way past what we can handle? Will AI be writing the medical textbooks of the future, actually?
Yes, I would just give you 2 points. So you're absolutely right. I think AI is actually can make things work worse. So I'll give you a simple example. We did a clinical trial on 62 people, and they, in some way, shape, or form, over the last year, they had complained of a chest ache. And all 62 actually ended up in a hospital, and on an average, $10,000 per person, so you can do the math. And then we took the same group, and then the next year, what we did was we gave them all these patches. And they could detect on their own that what they were going through was acid reflux because of what they ate, or they had some other muscular problem which was manifesting itself a chest ache. So out of the 62, only 2 people showed up in the hospital. So this was not about AI. It was empowering the customer and client to understand what is normal and what is not. It's very difficult to actually go in and look at data and say what's normal or not, but subjectively, pathologically, I know what I'm feeling. And if I can translate that into, yeah, this is normal stuff because that's the device telling me that, and it goes away because that's what happened last year, that's what it is. So we've found out in our case is machine learning is great, but we don't do diagnosis based on that. We provide enough data to the patient to say you're actually normal. So we have found 92% of the patients are actually normal when they have a chest ache. They're just so concerned they end up in the hospital. So, and then to answer your question about the data part of it, just as a backdrop, so we can actually take two ECGs, anonymous, do forensic analysis, and look at anomalies. So if we detect something new, we'll actually record it in the database. So next time when it shows up, I can tell you how your ECG has changed and what that anomaly has captured, actually. So hotspot analysis, where it's very valuable, actually. Yeah.
Another question?
Hi, I actually have two questions, and first one is more related to the science set. We both know that, as both of the professor has shown, that the genomes plays a very important part of detecting like cancers, what we see, but actually environmental factors also make a huge part of it. So how is the science actually tackling, like incorporating all the environmental factors to actually make sure the precision medicine really that accurate? So that's my first question. Second question is to Mr. Ravinder. Yeah, just wonder that you have demonstrated you have like basically managed to brought down the cost of for ECG from such like a thousand figure four digit figures to just one digit figures. Where do you see the breaking point of precision medicine at this moment to be? Consider all the testing is still quite expensive, and where do you think the business can go? Thank you.
Well, I'll do the first one. I mean, the environment, of course, it's hugely important. Sometimes the genetic analysis helps us to understand that. So, for example, with aflatoxin, which is a major predisposition, exposure to aflatoxin is a major predisposition to hepatocellular carcinoma in this part of the world. You can see a genetic signature of exposure, so you can actually measure people's exposure because that particular chemical affects the DNA in a particular way. So we're beginning to look at that very closely, and I think one of the exciting things, it's a big project run from the Sanger Institute in the UK and many other institutes, is to ask what is the pattern of mutations that occurs in the DNA of people who have cancer in their cancer cells, and can we use that to understand what exposures they've had? And in a sense, it's essentially exactly what you want because you're correlating the exposure to the event. So, I mean, in some ways, it's just confirmed what we knew. We can see a signature for tobacco. We can see a signature for UV light. But there are some other interesting signatures in there. So I think the future for what we call molecular epidemiology, which will bring these environment and genetic analysis together, is actually quite bright. And I think there may be some big surprises, actually. Can we go to another level with that? I think we can, because these types of very, very sensitive tests may allow us to detect low-level changes to the DNA and exposures to in the DNA that we can see over time. So I think it's a really strong area. It might grow very strongly. We'll see.
Let me add to what David has said. I think you touch upon a few, which is called epigenetics. And, the environment can change our epigenomes, and epigenomes are decoration on top of the genomes which give us a readout of the exposure. So it's for sure one of the very active areas of research, and many people are looking into that right now. So again, epigenetics is very important because that adds to the genetic factor as well.
I can't talk to this because I don't even understand what they're saying. But well, I'll focus on the question at hand in terms of cost. So, as you might have heard everyone here said, economies of scale actually drives the cost lower. So ultimately, it's the economies of scale. So I give you an example of how out-of-box thinking applies in this case. So we're looking at microfluidics to figure out how to do multiple tests on a single cartridge. It's a tricky problem because if you take 1 microliter of blood, how do you really spread it across enough areas? So work with a chemist trying to understand what flocculation is and some fancy words they told me I didn't understand. So but what came to my mind was if I go to an inkjet printer takes 1 microliter and spread it across 24 individual dots. And that's why the high DPI means dots per inch. So if I take that technology and take 1 microliter of blood, is there a way to create a system around it? So we have started a company, and part of the technology came from a university. So we have a single cartridge, one inkjet, literally an inkjet ball, which is broken into 64 pieces, and with 1 microliter, we can actually do 64 individual monochromatic light sources and count the number of cells. So we can give you mild to moderate dysplasia and lesions in the mouth without actually doing a biopsy. This was saliva. Now that cost today is about £2,000 in NHS. We can do the cartridge for $1.22. So it's not this, it doesn't really matter what it sells for. The critical part is that you have to take out-of-box technologies and combine them, because technology exists. What people have trying to figure out, how do you take all these different things and put them together? So that's where we come in. We sit down and say, what other technologies we can bring to the play, and then make all this. So what you'd see in that patch is nothing special. It's Wi-Fi and a bunch of stuff, but it's how you do it which makes a difference. So I just want to answer that from a cost perspective.
So let me use moderator privilege and just ask a question that's on my mind here. I'm thinking about, since I came from a technology industry, not a medical industry, I'm thinking about the math problem here, which is all the different things that go on in our lives, what we eat, what we do, the environment in which we are living, working, transient life, because there might be something on the airplane versus where I am at home, and then how I'm built. And I think about all the combinations that that represents, I guess a theoretically infinite number of combinations. How in precision medicine do we take on board all of those variables in order to know that how we're built and what we might be experiencing a day or a week or a month from now with all of those variations? How do we get to a point where there's an understandable picture? I think, Huck, you talked about it from a system perspective. How do we think of ourselves as a system given the infinite number of variables that go into it, even though we might know as a baseline how we're built, how those things might be triggered or not, somewhat to the question that was asked earlier. And I'm thinking about the trillions and trillions of combinations that that represents. How do you, as a scientist, think about consuming all of that data in order to have a relationship with me as an individual as I go through my daily life?
No, I mean, I wouldn't even, yeah.
Good.
I think that tell us how little we understand about human beings. And, well, you know, the good news is that there's tremendous plasticity and elasticity in our body. You know, our body can repair itself, and don't worry about the not so nice things we do to our body, you know, like, so the body can repair itself. And we just, in terms of thinking about health, we just have to make sure that we put our fair share in looking after ourselves, and don't think that there's always a magic bullet that come along the way that can erase all the things that we have done.
Yeah, I mean, I think one, well, I mean, it's one area that fascinates me is that all of us have about 5 kilograms of random organisms inside ourselves called our microbiome, which is actually very important. We know it keeps us very healthy. We know it's very important for our immune system, but we don't control it in any way. And if you think about that, we're kind of living in the wild, right? So I suspect one thing that might happen is that we'll begin to understand much more precisely who our friends are and make sure we have the right friends with us, because I suspect a lot of human health issues are related to that 5 kilograms.
It comes back to this idea that you take an antibiotic because you're trying to fix problem X and you wipe out all of these things that were also part of helping you stay healthy. Absolutely. And you just kill them. One last question before we end up trying to tie up for this evening, please.
Hi, thanks for the discussion so far. So I think we've talked a lot tonight about, you know, cancer and the application of genetics to cancer. I think, Sir David, you kind of alluded that there are other fields out there, and oncology is the easy target almost. So where next? Where do we take genetics to next? You mentioned psychiatry, you know, a lot of it's placebo effect, and the brain is another level of complexity. Is that where we're going next? Where are we challenging ourselves, and how do we get there? How do we bring the revolution that we're seeing in cancer to some of these other areas where you have very high non-response rates and people on, you know, very toxic drugs?
So, I think you've almost framed the answer in your question. I mean, I think the one area that's been enormously powerful is the study of human genetic variation. And the ability now to analyze very rapidly human genomes is allowing us to understand rare genetic defects. And what we're beginning to realize is that there's an enormous number of those defects. Probably every gene, because of the size of the human population, every gene that can be mutated has been mutated. And there's somebody living with that mutation. And that's hugely informative. And the institute my wife runs in IMB in Singapore and others have been plowing their way through these amazingly interesting examples of individuals with rare genetic disease. That gives us, I think, a fantastic baseline. And then we have the GWAS studies, which are asking, you know, what changes in genome composition seem to be associated with risk for, say, autism. And then we can begin to pull these things together and begin to understand and pull apart those issues. I think, you know, our genes are a predetermining factor of risk for many, many diseases. And I think that we will get to a much increased understanding of that association. And I think early detection can be enormously helpful. At the moment, it's difficult to screen. I call it the screening genie. Once you take the genie out of the bottle, you can never put it back. So if you said to women in Britain, actually, breast cancer screening isn't really that useful, which is quite good statistics to support, and I don't, you know, you know, you'll just be killed, right? And you didn't hear me say that, did you, any of you? So. But this is a kind of issue, so we need to subdivide risk groups in order to get value from screening, and then screening can become very valuable. So I think part of the future will be understanding risk and susceptibility and understanding better how to manage that variation, and that will come from genetic studies, starting off with these rare individuals with particular acute, if you like, mutations, but recognizing that all of us are different. So if I just look at my own field, you know, each one of you in this room will have a slightly different P53 allele, and you'll have a different MDM2 allele, and your ARF will be differently regulated. So every one of you is going to be at a certain threshold. And then if you eat curry, that threshold is going to change slightly, because that's quite a good inducer of the P53. So you understand the complexity. but we can begin to understand those things, and I think potentially intervene, actually, in quite interesting ways.
Was there one other... Were you going to ask a question? Just as a courtesy, I want to make sure I didn't miss you.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. That's the direction we're headed in. So we might understand that, you know, if you have this particular set of genetic alleles, genetic variations, that you're at risk for diabetes, and therefore you need to be monitored more carefully from a younger age. And we might also find that if you have that particular set of alleles, that you respond better to metformin, or you respond better to an exercise process. At the moment, we don't really just subdivide those things. So I think that is kind of the future that would be very hopeful for people is to understand better risk and understand better how to moderate and affect those risks. But in the end, unfortunately, we have another big risk factor, and that's called being human beings. And for example, I probably have a glass of wine tonight, which may not be such a good idea, but because I want to have a glass of wine. So, you know, we have to be realistic about all of this. There's another big factor in here, which is called the human identity, which we don't want to mess with, I don't think.
Well, I also want to highlight that not all diseases can be explained by genetics. So things like complex diseases, it's a combination of the interactions of environment with the different type of DNA variation in a human being that eventually leads to the manifestation of the disease. So cancer has a big genetic component. childhood disease has a big genetic component, but not everything can be explained by genetics.
And that from the Genome Institute.
So I guess the comment about wine was entirely predicated on whether it was a white or a red, because red apparently is amazing for your health. I always like to try and do a straw poll because this helps us understand market data. So from the informality of a straw poll, from everybody in the room, if you could tonight choose to have your genome sequenced and go away with some deep level of data that was interpreted for you, so don't just take the data, but somebody that walks you through that, would you choose to do that? I'm assuming, interestingly, Ravi, are you? Oh, okay, Okay, and the second thing is, if you were to be open to that type of information, would you share information about yourself, assuming there was reasonable assurances about anonymity and privacy, the idea that take this data and give it to someone for the purpose of aggregating and understanding something at a more macro level, would you choose to contribute that information, assuming anonymity was assured? Some yeses and some noes. So it's interesting, I just like to try and understand what's on people's mind, because we talk a lot about these things and then people say, but whatever we do, we certainly couldn't do it because people would be afraid, and I guess based on this straw poll, people are engaged. So what I'll do is say thank you to Sir David, to Huck, and to Ravi, and thank you to you. And there's food and drink at the back for those that want to hang around for a little while. Thanks again for coming.